Hello there. Welcome back to our Sky Tonight program. My name is Seth Mayo. I'm the curator of astronomy for the Lohmann Planetarium at MOAS. And in this edition of the program, we're covering the dates of January 24th through January 30th. We're going to start things off by saying farewell to the planet Jupiter that is starting to set in the west and southwest after sunset. We'll then say hello to the brightest star in our night sky that is conveniently rising in the east in the early evening. And to wrap up the episode, we're going to shift to the early morning sky where we can find Venus, Mars, and eventually the crescent moon. So let's get to it. This week, we can finally say farewell to the third brightest object in our night sky, or at least say temporarily goodbye to it in the evening. And that, of course, is the planet Jupiter that we find here kind of in the west southwest just after sunset, still lingering in this area of the sky. And we've had a good run with Jupiter. We've been seeing it in the evening since this last August up until now, and it helps that this massive planet shines so brightly in our sky, looking like a non-twinkling star. Now, speaking of looking at this planet, it's always great to look at through a telescope, as we've mentioned quite a bit in many of our recent episodes here, but just going back to it again, we'll zoom in to a more realistic telescopic view of Jupiter here. Even through that small telescope, you can see the cloudy bands of this gas giant world. And Jupiter really deserves the biggest planet in the solar system status. If you actually add up all the other planets and exclude Jupiter and mash them into one large planet, Jupiter would still be, impressively, 2.5 times more massive. It is truly very large, and if you compare directly with the Earth, it's about 10 or 11 times the size of our planet. You could fit over 1,300 Earths inside of it for volume, and it's about 318 times more massive than Earth as well. So we feel quite small in comparison to Jupiter. And even though this planet is so big, it actually has the fastest rotation of any other planet in the solar system. It only takes about 10 hours to rotate once. That is one day for Jupiter. So its appearance through a telescope changes quite quickly and dramatically, even if you watch it for a short period of time. And lately, we're still getting amazing pictures from NASA's Juno spacecraft that is still orbiting around this planet. Juno is on an extended mission since it first got to Jupiter back in 2016. This orbiting spacecraft has given us so much information, so many great observations of Jupiter, and it's important to study because Jupiter is the oldest planet we think in the solar system, so it kind of acts like a time capsule, helping us understand how planets formed in our solar system long ago. So we've learned a little bit more about that, learned a little more about Jupiter over the last few years, and we're still getting great pictures from the Juno spacecraft. Now, stepping back again through our telescopic view, what's also great is checking out those star-like objects near Jupiter. They almost look like stars, these little bright little dots around the planet, and those happen to be the moons of Jupiter, more specifically, the Galilean moons, the four largest moons that orbit this planet. Jupiter has a total of 80 moons. One more moon was added in 2021, so now we have a current number of 80. But the four largest that orbit quite close to Jupiter are very bright, and we have those Galilean moons you can see here. They're not always here. They move quite quickly around Jupiter, so if you look them through a telescope on a given night, you'll see them in different order or different configurations. But it's always neat to see those moons of a whole nother planet going around it. So in the time remaining we have with Jupiter, hopefully you get a chance to see it with the telescope, or at least with your naked eyes, still lingering in this area. And if we move on through the rest of this week here, this is the beginning of the week on Monday, but if we move to Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and then eventually we get to Friday and the weekend here, by the 29th and 30th, you'll see that Jupiter continues to descend lower and lower in the sky and eventually entering into the sun's glare, and that will continue to make it harder and harder to see. So take advantage of Jupiter's position in the sky right now, where we have a chance to see it in the evening before it reaches what's called superior conjunction on the other side of the sun, and then eventually transitioning into our morning sky later this year. As we watch Jupiter get very low in the west after sunset, if we look on the almost complete opposite side of the sky around that same time, at least in the early evening, we actually find the brightest star. We find the night sky rising. And that's this star right here, which is the star called Sirius. And just to make sure you found the star Sirius, you can actually use Orion's belt. As we've mentioned recently, Orion and his belt point you to the star Sirius. It's a great tool that I use all the time just to make sure I'm looking at the right object. So looking above Sirius here in the east-southeast, we find the great Orion the Hunter, wonderful winter constellation. There's Orion's belt. The three stars kind of line up in a row. And right now, if you point down towards the horizon, at least in the early evening, that will lead you pretty much directly to Sirius that we find here. And Sirius really does stand out as the brightest star in the night sky. It's almost twice as bright as the second brightest star in the sky, which is called Canopus, which is a star more easily seen in the southern hemisphere. And one misconception here floating around about the brightest star is that it's the north star. And if we look carefully here, you'll notice that we are definitely not anywhere near the north, more in the east and southeast, rising in this area. The North Star, as you may already know, obviously is in the north, and it's called Polaris. We'll actually can navigate to it. And the North Star is not very bright. Polaris is about 49th or 50th in brightness compared to all the stars you see at night. And it really does not stand out. And usually, if the Big Dipper is out, you can use the end of the bowl of the Big Dipper to point to the North Star. So that's the best way to find it there. So it's always good to kind of point out this misconception, and possibly the reason why the North Star is thought of as the brightest star is because the North Star is quite famous. So naturally, it would make sense that it would be the brightest, but again, turns out it is not. Sirius, the brightest star in the night sky, is the actual brightest one. And that brightness has been known since antiquity. If you go to the ancient Greeks, the name Sirius derives from the ancient Greek word Sirios, which means lit or glowing or scorching, because ancient observers definitely noticed the brightness of this star. And depending on the culture, the rising of this very, very luminous star coincided with a belief or tradition or the beginning of something. And to many, Sirius is also known as the dog star because it's part of the dog constellation. One of Orion's hunting dogs is situated right here called Canis Major. This is part of the head or the neck of Canis Major. So here's the head of this gray dog, the body, kind of the tail, the back legs and front legs are about here. So Sirius kind of lies near at least the front portion or near the head of this dog called Canis Major. So it kind of makes sense that this would also be known as the dog star. And we've talked about this before, but the term dog days of summer come from the dog star because long ago, the rising of this star, especially in the morning, when it was rising in the morning around July and August of each year, at least in the northern hemisphere, would indicate the hottest time of the year. So there was an idea that the scorching brightness of the star would add to the heat of the summertime, creating the dog days of summer, which typically are the hottest times of the year. All comes from the dog star, which again, we normally call Sirius, the brightest star in the night sky and within this constellation. And the reason why this star is so bright makes a lot of sense. It is one of the closest stars to us, a little over 8.5 light years away. That is still a tremendous distance from us. The light takes more than 8.5 years to travel from the star to reach your eyes here on Earth. But compared to most stars, it's one of the closer ones to us, and it's actually getting closer to us. Very slowly, our solar system and the star are nearing each other. So Sirius, over the years, will get brighter and brighter, and in about 60,000 years, interestingly, it will get to its brightest and then start to move away from us and get dimmer and dimmer. But at least for the next 210,000 years, it will be the brightest star in the night sky. So the brightness status for Sirius in our lifetime definitely doesn't really change. And over time, we've had a chance to know more about Sirius. It's actually a binary star, like most stars in the sky. Most stars are not solitary like our sun. Our sun's a bit of a loner star. Most stars are either binary or triple, or what are called trinary star systems. That's the most common configuration we've found in the sky so far. Stars are just made together much of the time. So Sirius is another one of those stars. So you have Sirius A and B, and that's not why it's so bright. Again, it's closeness, because Sirius A is a blue-white star that is much brighter than our sun, about 25 times brighter, about twice as massive, and almost twice as large. And that's the primary brightness for the star. It does have a companion, which is called Sirius B, which is a white dwarf star. It was a much bigger star early on. That star ran out of fuel, bloated up, pushed its gas into space, and left behind the dense core of the star called a white dwarf. and Sirius A, the brighter one, and Sirius B, the white dwarf, orbit around each other every 50 years. And so those two together can be resolved through really big observatories, big telescopes. But again, mostly you see the brightness of Sirius A, this blue-white hot star very near to us. And one thing that a lot of folks notice, especially when Sirius is low, it is twinkling quite dramatically, or its scintillation is very high. And you'll notice it go from red and blue and white and all these kind of cool colors, all of these interesting colors flashing very rapidly. And that's because the light you're seeing from the star low in the sky is going through more of our atmosphere because it's going through the curvature of our atmosphere. That atmosphere, which has different densities and different temperatures and is moving and is turbulent, refracts the light from the star quite dramatically, changing its color as you look at it. So a lot of people ask me about this. They see this really bright star, they notice it twinkling very drastically, and that's something you will notice when Sirius is very low. But at this time of the year, Sirius can be seen pretty much all night long. So this is only at the beginning of the evening. As you go through the night, Sirius will rise higher and higher, of course, as Earth rotates. So you see it from sunset all the way to about maybe a couple hours before sunrise. So at least the majority of the night and even a good portion of the early morning, as well as it moves across the east and southeast and into the southwest, at least for us here in Florida. This can change a little bit depending on your latitude. But for most places on Earth, you can find this star in the sky shining as a bright beacon of light fairly near to us compared to all of the other stars that we see in our night sky. As we shift over to the early morning before sunrise, looking towards the east and southeast, we can find some more planets in our sky. Now, very recently, we saw Venus leave the evening. We said farewell to it a couple episodes ago, and now Venus has reemerged in the morning. So Venus moves very quickly around the sun, being only the second planet from the sun in our solar system. So if you couldn't tell already, you can find Venus right here. It is the brightest planet that you can see in our sky. So it always stands out, even when it's near the sun, closer to the horizon. So that is really great to find Venus on a different side of the sky now. It doesn't last for too long, being obscured by the light from our sun. And to the right of it, it's not as bright, but you may notice its reddish glow, and that's the planet Mars. Mars was kind of in the morning sky by itself lately, and now has a planetary companion with Venus. So we got Mars there to the right, a little bit more to the south of Venus. Nearby, it won't be as bright, but again, you might see its reddish, rusty surface, giving it that iconic color that you see there. And what's also great is we have the moon joining in as well. So this is actually at the beginning of this week, but if we continue on through the next few mornings, all the way to the end of the week here, we're gonna find the waning crescent moon enter the scene here. So this is on the 26th, we'll get to the 27th, and then to the 28th here on Friday. Now it started getting closer and closer. It's a really nice crescent moon by Friday. It's actually situated inside some nice summer constellations. Really quick, this is Scorpius right here, great summer constellation, and Antares, the red heart of the scorpion. It's a really beautiful red giant star. So that's also nice to see in this area. And we'll continue on to the weekend here for the 29th. And by the 29th, you'll see the moon quite close to Mars. So that's considered a nice conjunction there. And then we'll continue on to the 30th here. The moon will be a very thin crescent by then, inside the sun's glare, but you still have a chance to see it, and above it, Mars and Venus as well. So we have some great objects to see in the early morning, at least when it comes to solar system objects that are moving about in our sky. Thanks for joining us for another edition of our Sky Tonight program. We always appreciate your support. And I always like to remind everybody that you can leave a comment or ask a question wherever we are posting this. We love to interact with you all and discuss what's going on in the sky and in the universe. So with that, we hope to see you back here again soon. Please come by the Museum of Arts and Sciences if you're in Daytona Beach. We've got a lot of great exhibits on display. And of course, if you have time, make it to our Lohmann Planetarium. We are running shows daily. And if you want more information about our exhibits and our show schedule, check our website online. With that, we hope to see you back here again. Take care and happy stargazing.